thanks for the introduction, Jerry, and thank you all for coming here tonight. I appreciate that people take time out of busy schedules to come in on weeknights when you'd rather be tucked up at home having a glass of wine by the fire. But thank you all for coming out, and I hope I haven't disillusioned you with the topic that I chose several months ago when I was originally contacted by the division to present this paper and I had to come up with a title. At the time, I was trying to draft a detailed submission to the National Consultation on Human Rights. And I was getting absolutely sick to death of reading complex legal analysis and really pathetic rhetorical statements from some quarters of the debate. And it just seemed to me that I was trawling through, you know, copious amounts of material trying to get to the actual crux of the issue. Most of it, I should admit, has been written by lawyers. And so I came up with the title. Okay, I'm just going to cut through all of that rubbish and I'm going to talk about getting beyond the legalese and beyond the rhetoric of this debate and to dispel some of the myths and uncover some of the motivations which are actually pushing certain sectors of the human rights debate in Australia. So I came up with this, what I thought was a great title at the time, until it came down to the point of having to prepare this paper. And I thought, my God, I can't even write a page without descending into legalese. And I'm pretty good at rhetoric too when I want. So I actually have got you here under false pretenses. And for that, I'll make an apology right from the outset. So you have a complete disclaimer from me. I was going to suggest that because of that, I will allow heckling until I ran into Drew Dawson at the coffee shop today. And he said, Wendy, I'm coming tonight simply to heckle you. I thought, oh God, I'm not going to do my opening thing now. But if I do descend into really complex technical jargon, just cough loudly or throw things at me and I'll try and backpedal and see how I go in talking in English for a change. It's a really difficult audience to pitch it to because I'm guessing a fair chunk of you are lawyers or law students or have some experience in the law, but then a number of you probably wouldn't and probably come at it from all sorts of disciplinary angles. So if I am sort of speaking over your head, just keep coughing and I'll eventually get the message and try to backtrack. Okay, so let's start from effectively what is the point of departure for tonight's talk. And that is the current National Consultation on Human Rights, which has been played out at the federal level. It was announced on the 10th of December last year by the Federal Attorney General Robert McClelland, who made the announcement that there would be a national consultation on human rights and announced the members of the consultative committee who would be charged with conducting that inquiry and reporting back to Parliament. That happened on what is International Human Rights Day, which last year also marked the 60th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. On that very day, we were in here running a human rights symposium to honour that particular day and to consider mechanisms for improving human rights protection. And we had a senior person from the Federal Attorney General's office who was just waiting for a text message to say that he could make the announcement because the attorney had simply done it. But we already knew prior, or shortly after the federal election in 2007, that this was going to take place. It had been a part of Labor Party platform in the lead up to the election, and we knew that Robert McClelland was really keen to conduct this national inquiry. We also knew in the first budget that $2 million had been set aside for the purposes of establishing this consultative committee. And so they were charged, the terms of reference that were given to that committee had three questions. The first was what human rights and freedoms should be protected in Australia. The second was, are those rights and freedoms currently or sufficiently protected under Australian law? And the third question was, how might we go about better protecting those rights and freedoms? Now, in preparing for tonight's talk, I actually read every single publicly available submission I could get my hands on. I reckon I was tipping at 350 submissions, some of which, I might say they all come from lawyers, were well over 100 pages in length. But a number of them are also very short email contributions that were submitted online to the consultative committee. My take on that small sample, and it's only small because over 38,000 people, or 38,000 people and groups made submissions to that consultative process, and 66 community roundtables were held throughout the country. So it was probably one of the biggest, if not the biggest, consultative process ever conducted in the history of our federation. Now, all I can access are the 300 to 350 submissions that I could publicly that were publicly available online. So I don't know whether they were truly representative, and I did endeavour to contact a few people that I know inside Attorney Generals who were still unable to tell me whether my dodgy stats were even reflective of the overall submissions that were received by the committee. The overwhelming response, however, was that Australians, and probably about three quarters of those who made submissions, don't think that we sufficiently protect human rights currently, and that we need to do something more by way of giving us better protections for human rights in Australian law. There is a very loud group of about 25% who are absolutely adamant that they don't want a statutory Bill of Rights. In a moment I'll show you who some of those people are. The main reason which is informing that particular perspective is that to give or to implement a Bill of Rights and to involve the courts in that process would be to fundamentally change Australia's system of government. Now, in tonight's lecture, I'd like to go through some of those things and dispel some of the myths which inform that process. But at the same time, I also want to take stock at the lawyers' contributions, because I think that this debate is currently being dominated by lawyers, and that's of necessity in many respects, because any question about how we might better protect human rights is inevitably going to involve considerable calls for significant law reform, and so lawyers need to be there to inform that process. In my mind, however, the lawyers who are most actively engaged in the Australian debate at present are pushing one perspective at the expense of other perspectives which may indeed be better suited to Australia's federal constitutional system. So I'm going to take the two polemical views within the debate and pull them apart and hopefully identify a better way forward that I perceive would be better suited to our constitutional system. So that's where I'd like to go today. Okay, here's some of the people who are involved in the legalese and the rhetoric. Some of them you would be able to identify fairly clearly. If you look to the left of screen, you have people like Justice Michael Kirby, now Mr. Kirby. Above him is Professor George Williams, who was pivotal in, or actually chaired the consultative committee that informed the Victorian Charter. So he was quite instrumental in the development of the Victorian Statutory Bill of Rights. Next to George is the Honourable Catherine Branson, who is currently on leave from the Federal Court of Australia and is now the President of the Australian Human Rights Commission. Below her is Professor Hilary Charlesworth, who chaired the Consultative Committee for the Australian Capital Territories consultative process, which led again to a statutory Bill of Rights in those two jurisdictions. Those people on that side of the wall all are pursuing statutory models for a Bill of Rights in Australia. They are all based on the adoption of a dialogue model. I mean, Justice Kirby has only really given support for the idea of a Bill of Rights. He hasn't really come up with a specific model which he favours. But they are all clearly of the mindset that Australia needs a National Human Rights Act to ensure the protection of human rights throughout the country. Across on this side, we have the other extreme. So you have Bob Carr, you have the current New South Wales Attorney General, John Hatzisturgis, you have George Brandis, who is the shadow Attorney General at the federal level, and you have Janet Albrechtson, who is legally trained but writes a column in the Australian. Those people are absolutely, adamantly opposed to the adoption of any statutory Bill of Rights, on the premise that it shifts power from the Parliament to the courts and that in doing so you would fundamentally change the way our system of government operates. And the minute you come out with that type of rhetoric, Australians tend to get nervous and they don't like change and they certainly don't want change to their constitution. Now, Robert McClelland, the Federal Attorney General, actually limited the terms of reference of the Consultative Committee. So we have no prospect of constitutional reform coming out of this process. It was specifically limited, and I actually went back over the background paper which came out with the consultative process. It's quite a lengthy, detailed booklet, but there's one tiny sentence, the last sentence in the booklet, which says, "The options identified should preserve the sovereignty of the Parliament and not include a constitutionally entrenched Bill of Rights." They left it right till the very end, but it was very clear that the current federal government is not inclined towards supporting or pushing or promoting constitutional reform. So we have this idea of parliamentary sovereignty still generating the limits of the constitution, of the consultative process which is currently underway. And that is a little bit problematic. Let me take you to the people in the middle. At the top you've got the Honourable, or former Justice of the High Court, Michael McHugh, who has been particularly vocal in recent months in the national debate. And Michael's perspective is premised on the fact that the dialogue model, which is the statutory model for a Bill of Rights which the ACT and Victoria has, which they are both modelled on the United Kingdom's Human Rights Act, that dialogue model is constitutionally invalid, that it includes as its centrepiece the capacity for the courts not to invalidate legislation which is inconsistent with human rights, but to issue a declaration of incompatibility. So it's a mere declaration which then triggers a process whereby the attorney then has to go back into Parliament, and Parliament must then consider whether to leave the incompatibility standing or to reform the law. So this idea of a declaration of incompatibility is highly questionable in terms of its constitutional validity. And Michael McHugh has entered the debate around that central issue. Would it be constitutionally valid for us to give the federal courts, the High Court, the power to issue a declaration of incompatibility? Because of that constitutional complexity, I think that the debate surrounding this consultative process is more complex from a legal and constitutional process than some of the debates which have preceded it. For example, when Gareth Evans or Lionel Bowen in the 80s tried to adopt statutory bills of rights or a constitutional model, that the politics which surrounded those debates centred on federalism. So it was a bit of a bun fight between the Commonwealth and the states over power. And the idea that the Commonwealth would entrench human rights protection meant that the states were then going to have to toe the line. And that raised massive issues surrounding federal politics. And inevitably, those measures didn't actually get up. Come a few decades, or nearly 21 years later, from the last major push for reform, and we have a situation where it's the actual model that's being put forward by the human rights advocates and lawyers promoting a statutory Bill of Rights that itself creates significant constitutional problems. And I think that that is its major weakness. The fact that we have a majority of lawyers pushing a dominant model which they prefer, which federal parliament is probably not going to touch because it's likely to be held invalid. Now, it may be that many of us who are engaged in the constitutional debate are wrong, and that the High Court may indeed hold it to be valid. But I don't know a federal government who's likely to risk that, especially when you've got such a vocal group of people that include Bob Carr and include George Brandis in the federal opposition, who are likely to push that type of measure through to the federal parliament on the basis that it potentially is constitutionally valid. And I think that therein lies a major problem with the dominant model. The two last men who many of you may not know, to the right is Reverend Professor Michael Tate, who was the Minister for Justice under the Hawke Labor government in the 80s. And Michael was pivotal in the adoption of the War Crimes Act. And he has recently come out, given his political and his religious background, to enter the debate and to make a contribution. And his contribution, as with the other gentleman who I haven't mentioned, which is Professor John Eure, Professor of Politics from the ANU, they are both pushing for parliamentary reform. So that rather than give the courts the major say as to whether our human rights are being protected or not, so that the courts become your major institution in implementing the Bill of Rights, that they would prefer to just reform parliamentary processes so that we would establish potentially a joint standing committee on human rights that would be similar in style and structure and process as, for example, the Joint Standing Committee on Treaties, which was adopted in 1996 by Alexander Downer. That type of reform is currently supported by both arms of government. So both the Liberals and the Labor Party appear to support the idea of reforming parliamentary process. It's also an idea which is supported by people on both sides of the human rights debate. So in my mind, that stands as being the most likely reform to come out of this consultative process. But on its own, it doesn't do enough. And there are two reasons why I think that parliamentary reform is insufficient. The first is that under international human rights law and all of the treaties which Australia is a party to, require us to provide remedies for individuals. Now, those remedies need not necessarily be enforced by a court, but they need to be enforceable. So they could be ordered by a tribunal or another independent statutory body, but they just simply need to be enforced. So they need a court to back them up. A measure which simply looks at parliamentary reform doesn't provide that mechanism for addressing breaches of human rights, and it fails to comply with our legal obligations under international law. So that's the first drawback. The other one is I just think it doesn't do enough in terms of a whole of government approach. And you can't just look at laws, you need to look at policies and administrative decisions and also what the courts do in their day-to-day role. So in my mind, parliamentary reform is going to happen, or it's certainly the most likely to happen as a result, but it certainly doesn't go far enough. Another point that should be mentioned is that we have the Australian Human Rights Commission, or formerly the Human Rights and Equal Opportunity Commission. That body needs significant funding and it needs to be revisited. It's an absolute dog's breakfast, the legislative framework which surrounds that body. As a body, it is subject to political whims and their budget is constantly being tinkered with. And so their capacity to educate and do training on human rights issues and their capacity to offer a proper complaint handling process is always potentially going to be under the hammer at budget time. So that body needs considerable reform, and that should come out of this process, and I hope that it does. At the bottom of the screen are our four consultative committee members. We have Father Frank Brennan, Mary Costakidis, Mick Palmer and Tammy Williams. Now, on my reckoning, only two people on that page don't have law qualifications. So that tells you the dominant people in the debate, the people who are really driving this, are lawyers. We are disproportionately represented on both sides of the debate. And that explains a lot of the legal complexity and explains a lot of the waffle and a lot of the rhetoric. So, okay. Before I go through and give you what I think should happen out of this process, I thought it was best if I really gave you a potted history of human rights in Australia to explain why we even got to this point of needing reform and to consider some of the broader legal issues which are informing the debate and which also set the parameters for what the consultative committee will actually be able to achieve at the end of the day. So how are human rights protected in Australia? It's become almost trite to say that we're the last remaining modern Western democracy without a Bill of Rights, whether it's a statutory model or a constitutional model. And that's certainly a reality. The fact, though, is, and this is what people like George Brandis and Bob Carr regularly repeat in the media, is that we live in a fairly free, open, democratic society. For the most part, that's entirely true. But for most of us, our rights aren't being repeatedly breached. And I think that recent cases, some of which I'll refer to in the next few slides, have indicated that Australia has reached a point where we're simply not doing enough and we're not reaching the mark that we set for ourselves when we signed up to a whole heap of international human rights instruments. We should be measured by how we treat our most marginalised group. And on that front, we're simply not doing good enough. So the push has been to really develop our legal and constitutional protections of human rights. And so the debate has really been pushed by a number of policy and legal developments that happened specifically during the Howard era. Whether that be for refugees or for Indigenous peoples, I think that the community started to sit up and take notice. And I think that that public displeasure in the treatment of certain marginalised groups is informing this debate, and it is encouraging more people from the community to actually engage, even though they themselves enjoy relative freedom. So how do we fare on the rights front? What rights do we have as Australians? I was reading something the other day and looked at some stats on some surveys that had been conducted by some colleagues in New South Wales, and it showed that very few Australians actually have any idea that they really don't have any human rights protected. Very few, anyway. They all perceive that the Constitution provides adequately for our individual rights and freedoms. And that simply is not the case. Most people are actually shocked to find out that that's the reality. Our Constitution was set up to really allow for discriminatory practices. Our government was entitled to discriminate against minorities, and our Constitution was drafted with that in mind, specifically to discriminate against Indigenous peoples and Asians who were coming here to work in the minefields and so forth. So our Constitution only has a handful of rights, and they are patchy and they are incomplete and they are subject to the vagaries of constitutional interpretation. We have things like the right to a trial by jury under Section 80, but that right can be totally manipulated by the federal parliament, because the right to a trial by jury only attaches to indictable offences. But who gets to determine what is an indictable offence? Federal parliament. The High Court doesn't set a specific benchmark, and so the parliament has been able to manoeuvre around that when they want to. There's also things like we actually thought that we had a right to vote under Section 41, but the High Court interpreted that to say that that was basically spent. It was really just to protect those who had the right to vote in the colonies at Federation, but as soon as the Federal Parliament had introduced its own Electoral Act, then that was the end of Section 41. We have had some cases since then which indicate that we have an implied right to vote, but it's subject to implication, which means different judges at different times will have a different interpretive approach to determining the content of that right to vote. And I could go on. You have very few rights. You have the right to, if the government acquires your property, you have the right to just terms. And that's the whole castle scenario. You have the right not to be discriminated against on the basis of your state residence. And we have the right to free interstate trade, commerce and intercourse. We have very, very few entrenched, expressly provided for rights and freedoms. And they are certainly incomplete and inadequate. The High Court throughout the 80s and mostly in the 1990s did identify that we had some implied freedoms stemming from the structure and the text of our Constitution. The most important one to be aware of is the implied freedom of political communication. Now, that only applies to events like this. Here we are talking about politics, and so if we're going to defame anyone, we could potentially use the implied freedom of political communication as a potential defence. So that's the way it works in a very indirect way. But again, that was a freedom which the High Court found to be implied in the Constitution based upon the system of representative and responsible government that Section 7 and 24 in particular provided for. Some other decisions of the High Court have looked at other implied freedoms, including freedom of association. And the High Court, we haven't had a full majority of the court identify and accept that that implied freedom exists. But arguably it does, and we would assume that the High Court would support that as being something which is almost attached to the implied freedom of political communication, that you can't participate in a representative democracy if you can't associate with others and debate freely the politics of the day. Others have tried to argue that certain rights and freedoms are protected through Chapter 3, which is the separation of judicial power, and that stems to the exercise of powers by the judiciary, so that you can only be subjected to a trial which is fair. I would argue that that is not a protection under Chapter 3 of the Constitution, although Chapter 3 does operate in a way which indirectly protects some of the rights and freedoms that we would traditionally associate with the judicial process. The fact is, our Constitution provides us with scant protection of our basic rights and freedoms. Many aren't there. It also enables and continues to enable the Parliament to discriminate freely against even Indigenous peoples. So it's simply inadequate as a means of protecting us. Statutes are fairly patchy and piecemeal. Most of them deal with discrimination, and most of them provide inadequate remedies. So the Australian Human Rights Commission, for example, can conduct investigations and can conciliate disputes that involve potential breaches of your human rights. But again, it's simply inadequate in terms of the breadth of our international legal obligations with regard to all manner of rights and freedoms. So we simply haven't gone far enough. And many of those acts that we adopted, the Race Discrimination Act, the Sex Discrimination Act, were often measures which happened as a result or in between the failed attempts to develop a national statutory Bill of Rights or to promote constitutional reform, for example, in the 1988 referendum. So they're patchy and they're completely inadequate in terms of giving effect to our international legal obligations. The third one is the common law, and many of you would be aware that the common law, although it protects us in ways that, specifically with respect to how the judiciary operates, so we have the right to silence and the right to be presumed innocent until proven guilty and so forth, that bundle of rights which we tend to associate with the right to a fair trial, personal liberty, freedom of expression, the right to privacy, these rights and freedoms are all recognised at common law, but they're all subject to parliamentary supremacy. So even though the judges might identify that the common law protects the right to privacy or the right to freedom of expression, when Parliament acts, the Parliament will override the common law. So any common law mechanisms are really becoming, or common law protections, I should say, are becoming smaller and smaller as the amount of legislation itself expands. So again, the common law is inadequate. International law can be indirectly used. It's not directly incorporated into our legal system unless Parliament acts. So without legislation from the Parliament, which gives effect to our international legal obligations, only indirect use of those obligations can be had in our domestic legal system. The most obvious one is with respect to statutory interpretation and the development of the common law by the courts. So Mabo, for example, was a case where the High Court developed the notion or the idea of native title by referring to international human rights law. In Alcateb, you had the Chief Justice Gleeson, interpreting the Migration Act consistently with international human rights standards, but he was in the minority. So international law, unless Parliament deliberately acts to give effect to international legal standards on human rights, it can only have a very indirect effect in our legal system. And so when you look at the institutions, it's really Parliament that we need to decisively act to give proper effect to international human rights standards. The executive government also has the potential through the development of policy and the making of administrative decisions. So if there's a decision of government to deport you because your visa's expired, that is a decision made by the executive government, normally by the minister. Now, the minister can, when exercising his or her discretion, choose to take into account international human rights standards. The problem is that that discretion is rarely exercised, and it's almost up to the individual decision maker as to whether to even consider those international or those human rights implications of their decision. The same goes for the judiciary. When you even talk about the indirect use of international human rights and the interpretive powers of the courts to use human rights norms, they again are subject to the discretion of the judge. So the judge doesn't necessarily need to even apply those interpretive principles to refer to international human rights law when developing the common law, or to consider human rights standards when interpreting the statute. You only need to look at the decision of Al-Khattab, which involved the indefinite detention of an illegal immigrant, to identify that, well, why did two or three judges feel that it was okay to interpret, or that they had to interpret, the Migration Act consistently with human rights, and yet the four majority judges felt that it was absolutely impossible. Some of them didn't even really refer to it. So this idea of the interpretive principles being subject to the whim of judges is a problem, as far as I'm concerned. State and territory governments, however, operate within their own jurisdictional sphere, and they have the capacity, even outside the federal government, to give greater effect to human rights. Now, our state and territory governments all have adopted equal opportunity and anti-discrimination legislation, but the ACT in Victoria pushed through in adopting statutory bills of rights based on the UK model. And that model included the Declaration of Incompatibility that I referred to earlier. Now, why does that model work so well at a state and territory level and yet can be so problematic, as far as I'm concerned, with at the federal level? The fact is, we have a written constitution at the federal level which has a very strict and entrenched separation of judicial power, so that what powers you can give to courts at the federal level is much narrower than what you can give to the Supreme Court, for example, at the state level. Our state constitutions don't have that same entrenched separation. And so what you can do with a statutory Bill of Rights is quite different to what you can do at the federal Bill of Rights. A federal Bill of Rights has to be very careful in terms of what powers it gives to courts, because if it doesn't involve what's considered to be judicial power, it's going to be invalid. And therein lies the problem. You have a declaration of incompatibility which doesn't invalidate an inconsistent statute. It doesn't even lead to a statute being inoperative. It's just a declaration. And many constitutional lawyers believe that that doesn't involve the determination of a controversy, which is what the federal courts have to be engaged in. Our federal courts, and this is a very early decision in the early years of the Federation, said that the federal courts, so that's the High Court, the federal courts, the family court, cannot exercise what's called an advisory opinion. You can't just go along to the High Court and say, look, can you tell us whether this is constitutionally valid? It needs to be an exercise of judicial power that involves a dispute between two parties, where there's an application of law to determine the rights, duties or liabilities of those two parties. So going to the court to get a declaration of incompatibility creates problems. What is its legal effect? Well, its legal effect is it triggers a process that means the attorney has to then go and talk to Parliament, and Parliament then needs to determine. But as far as the courts are concerned, it's an order given by the court that really doesn't legally determine, or not with any sense of finality, in my mind, the dispute between the parties. Now, the analysis that I've just given to you is based upon constitutional jurisprudence. And I accept that that jurisprudence may shift. And I've actually written and published in 2004 a piece which suggested there were ways that the High Court could develop its jurisprudence to allow this type of declaration in a human rights context. Now, I knew that I was pushing the boundaries in 2004, and I still think that I would be pushing the boundaries in 2009. Therein lies the problem. If you want to adopt a statutory Bill of Rights based upon the dialogue model at the federal level, there's a big group of constitutional lawyers, including Michael McHugh and a number of other former High Court judges, who believe that it's 50-50 whether the High Court might change its jurisprudential approach, and which federal government is going to risk something as major as a National Human Rights Act by including a mechanism as its centrepiece which is likely to be held to be constitutionally valid. My guess is that this government probably won't pursue that model. Anyway, let me keep going. The fact is, there's a real need for reform. And Al-Khattab and Godwin was what Michael McHugh described as that tragic case, where an individual who was effectively stateless and who had pursued every legal avenue in Australia to try and stay here and to be granted asylum, had pursued all those avenues legally and was simply in a position where he should have been deported. The fact is, he was Palestinian and was stateless, and no country would take him back. So Australia, the government, was caught between a rock and a hard place. Legally, they couldn't release him under the Migration Act unless the minister exercised discretion, but they simply couldn't send him back to his country of origin. So he became a detainee who was likely to be indefinitely detained under the Migration Act. The legality of that was challenged in Al-Khatib, and a 4-3 decision determined that the Migration Act, in allowing for the indefinite detention of an individual like Al-Khatib, was valid under our constitution. Now, it was probably, I hate teaching this case in constitutional law. I think it is absolutely appalling, and I tend to focus very heavily on the minority judges when I'm teaching it, particularly Chief Justice Gleeson. It's just an awful, appalling state of affairs that our constitution can enable our government to detain indefinitely an individual. It's just simply appalling. The fact that that potential, I mean, that legal ability can also extend to children, as other migration cases have demonstrated, that the Migration Act can validly be used to lock away children, but even in their formative years, is, I think, just an appalling state of affairs. Cartanieri, this is the Hindmarsh Island Bridge case, which no doubt you're probably more familiar with than I am. I was living in Tasmania at the time, but you know, we were used to frequently hearing about the Hindmarsh Island Bridge case on the news every single evening. So we followed it quite closely. This decision of the High Court effectively came to the conclusion that the racist power under Section 51 of the Constitution can be used, or potentially used, to act in a manner which is adverse to a particular race, so that you can single out a race and do something adverse to them. In that particular case, you had the Aboriginal Cultural and Heritage Protection Act was overruled by the Hindmarsh Island Bridge Act. And the issue was, could you validly use the racist power to remove protections that had been previously given by another act? Now, not everyone, not all of the judges, definitively stated that, yes, you can use the racist power to adversely affect a particular race and single them out. They used a very technical, legal, interpretive process to do it, that what Parliament can do with one hand, it can also take away with the other. So it was a simple power of legislation that impacted on some of the decisions. But we still have a situation. Cartanieri, together with a number of other cases, tells us that the government is clearly within its power to legislate in a manner which discriminates against Indigenous Australians in an adverse manner. And that, I think, is another unacceptable fact of our constitutional framework. The Northern Territory Emergency Response Plan, that involved the suspension of the Racial Discrimination Act to enable or facilitate the intervention. And that in itself is, again, I think, a very problematic aspect. The fact that this bill, which went to over 500 pages, was given 2 hours before it was to be debated, and that the opposition parties simply didn't have enough time to digest it, let alone be able to effectively engage in the debate in Parliament, is another really problematic aspect that warrants consideration. I could talk forever about counter-terrorism laws and criminal intelligence laws, including the bikies legislation, but I think I don't need to say too much to put the point out there that parliaments throughout the country are tearing away a basic and fundamental liberties that we've simply taken for granted. The fact that we just assumed that no court could engage in a process that didn't provide procedural fairness to the individuals involved. The fact that you are supposed to know the case against you and be able to given a proper opportunity to answer it has seemingly been sidelined in a number of cases. And that in itself is problematic, not because governments on occasion need to interfere with human rights to affect government policy, but the fact that human rights are at the margins of that debate. simply because governments aren't held accountable on human rights issues. So that, I believe, is another example of why we need reform. The constitutional issues, well, I've already flagged a lot of them. Our federal parliament clearly has the power to enact a statutory Bill of Rights, and the external affairs power gives them the power to implement every single international human rights treaty that it's adopted. Throughout the 80s and the early 90s, we had massive battles in the High Court, from Commonwealth dams to the Daintree rainforest case, where states and the Commonwealth went head to head, and it was clearly and repeatedly stated by the High Court that the Parliament has enormous power to give effect to its international legal obligations. So they can use the external affairs power to give effect to a statutory Bill of Rights. There's no question there whatsoever. The issues, though, that are impacting upon the current debate really stem from Chapter 3 of the Constitution, which is this separation of judicial power, and the fact that it creates problems as soon as you engage the courts but don't give them the power to invalidate or declare laws inoperative. With a declaration of incompatibility, you're giving the courts the power to make a declaration which Parliament can simply ignore. The idea being that that creates a dialogue. Well, what if Parliament ignores it? There's no dialogue there. How on earth is that going to impact upon Parliament's behaviour? Is it going to lead to more rigorous debate in Parliament? Or will it have an impact upon the way the courts actually approach these declarations of incompatibility? In my mind, it does have the potential to politicise the courts simply because you haven't given them sufficient power that is akin to the powers that they already exercise under our constitution. If you're going to set something as being a legal standard, and that's what we're talking about when we talk about protecting human rights, you can't say to the courts, look, here, go and measure this law in accordance with that standard, but you really can't do anything legally to say that it's inoperative or it's ineffective. You're getting the courts involved in a process which is almost meaningless, and I think it simply doesn't go far enough. If the rights are worth protecting, and if you want to measure and prescribe Parliament's power to interfere with them, they need to be constitutionally entrenched. Or you adopt a statutory Bill of Rights like they had in Canada in 1960, which enables the court, subject to Parliament's express intention to override the Bill of Rights, but it enables the court not to invalidate the law, but to declare it as being inoperative if it's inconsistent with the Human Rights Act. I think that type of power is much more akin with the powers of the courts that we're traditionally used to under our federal constitution. In my mind, a dialogue model simply doesn't go far enough, and I think it creates almost an arguable case for invalidity based on Chapter 3 case law. The other problem that flows from the Constitution, which is impacting upon the debate currently, is the place of the states. And if we adopted a National Bill of Rights, what extension of that legislation would you pass on to the states? Now, Section 109 says that if you have a state law and a federal law and they're inconsistent, then the state law becomes inoperative to the effect of that inconsistency. But Parliament can actually clear the field. So the federal parliament can put in an express provision saying that it may not necessarily lead to that the intention is to create complementary laws so that a national Human Rights Act would act in a way which is complementary to the existing human rights acts that we have in the ACT in Victoria. So it just requires a bit of careful drafting, but you can certainly have a situation where the human rights acts, even though they operate slightly differently in different jurisdictions, they can act in a manner which is complementary. But it's certainly something that impacts upon the debate. The other issue is implied immunities. One government, and my students' eyes always glaze over when I start talking about this doctrine in constitutional law classes, but it means that the Commonwealth government cannot use its legislative power to have an impact upon the operation of the state governments and impair their capacity to function as governments. So you couldn't have a National Human Rights Act which dictated to state parliaments and required, and if there was a declaration of incompatibility, that their parliaments would have to respond. That would be a breach of the implied immunities doctrine under our constitution. So although you can extend your laws to the states, there are some constitutional limits, and it's about protecting the core functions of government at all the different levels. So they're the constitutional issues. And I know that's probably heavy going. I haven't heard too much coughing, though. Okay, options for reform. I'm going way over time, Jerry, aren't I? Okay. Constitutional reform's out of the question. Federal Human Rights Act. Well, it's out of the question for now. I think down the track we have to go there. But Robert McClellan doesn't want it, so it's not going to be on the table. The Federal Human Rights Act or Federal Charter, there's, I think, two options. You could go for the dialogue model, which, as I've just said, I think it's dodgy and is arguably not going to get up. You could go for the option of the Canadian Bill of Rights. That, I think, is problematic and probably doesn't have the political support that you would want to get it through. The other thing is I think you should repeal and redevelop the framework, the legislative framework surrounding the Australian Human Rights Commission, or what was based on the Human Rights and Equal Opportunity Commission Act. I think that that should go together with amendments to the Act's Interpretation Act, so you could change the obligations on courts and say that, you know, it's not up to you anymore whether you consider human rights when interpreting a statute. We're going to say that you have an obligation to interpret this statute as far as possible so that it's consistent with the human rights, provided that it's consistent with the overall purpose of the statute and that judges aren't rewriting the legislation. I also think that the Act's Interpretation Act can be amended to make sure that any person exercising an administrative discretion and any judge exercising a judicial discretion has an obligation to take into account human rights when they make that decision. And I think that they're really simple, you know, that's just three new provisions of the Act's Interpretation Act, and really simple. The other idea is parliamentary reform, and as I've already said, that's likely to get up and happen anyway. So here are my ideas on how we might move forward, because I don't think that the political will is going to really get behind. I mean, I might be wrong on this, and maybe Robert McClelland may push the agenda. I can't see it happening given the constitutional complexities which are attached to the model which is being favoured and promoted as the dominant model at the moment. I think that we need to develop an Australian human rights or declaration of human rights, and I think it should not be a legal instrument. It should just be a basic statement that my kids, my 10-year-old, my stepdaughter could read and make sense of and talk about in classrooms. I think that the tendency of lawyers to take over the debate and to take the human rights and make them really complex and embed them in a really complex statutory framework does not enhance the capacity of the public to engage with it. And it doesn't promote education, and it doesn't promote the purposes for which you would want to adopt a Human Rights Act. I think that we need to limit the role of the courts. I think we need to depoliticise the debate and say, okay, the courts will be great if they are involved, but if we can't get a really strong model because it's politically not feasible, we need to remove that idea of the courts being involved. And I think that the best way that we could actually do that is to simply set up a new tribunal, a human rights tribunal, where you could go to the tribunal to get a remedy, and that if they stuffed up on a question of law, then you could go into a court and have judicial review. But that would be the limit of the court's involvement. And I think that that would take away a lot of the rhetorical argument seen from some sides of the debate. I think it have to improve parliamentary processes, and I think that that's just a no-brainer. I think that we can also build upon Australia's administrative law framework. The idea that we have tribunals and ombudsmen to provide us with cheap, effective remedies that don't require litigation is the way to go. If you have a look at any of the recent annual reports of bodies like the Administrative Appeals Tribunal and the Commonwealth Ombudsman, Australians are going to these bodies at much higher numbers, increasingly, with each year. For example, the Commonwealth Ombudsman had a 20% increase in its most recent annual report. We had a 30% increase in the Australian Human Rights Commission receiving complaints and inquiries. We had a 50% increase in appeals going to the Social Security Appeals Tribunal. This is the type of remedy that Australians want, and I think we need to use our administrative law framework to provide an alternative to the courts. And I think we need to reinvigorate the Australian Human Rights Commission. Their budget has been dwindled, even under the Rudd government. It copped a 40% reduction in its budget under Howard, and we saw a 12.5% reduction in it in the last financial year. I think that if you're going to support human rights, you've got to properly fund it. So they're my ideas. The only other thing that I would probably finish is I think that we need to reformulate the Australian Human Rights Commission framework. And I would say that we need to split up some of its functions. We need to take the legal services and the complaint mechanism and give it to an ombudsman. I think Australians are really familiar with the concept of an ombudsman, and I think providing sufficient funds and resources to properly support that would promote Australians' engagement with the whole human rights framework. So I think leave the education and training and the leadership on human rights issues to the Commission, but then you would have an ombudsman take over the legal stuff and the complaint handling processes. I would also then develop a human rights tribunal as a sort of a last stop. If you couldn't get an effective remedy from the ombudsman, then you would have the option of going to a tribunal which could provide very flexible remedies that were tailored to ensure that they were constitutionally valid and appropriate for the circumstances, and that the decisions of the tribunal would be subject to judicial review. So I'm going to stop there because I realised I've gone over time. But they're my ideas, and I think that by adopting a proposal or developing ideas for reform which are much better reflected in the way that they would actually fit within the Australian federal context needs to be considered. And I think that there's many Australian human rights lawyers who've participated in the debate have actually sold us short. And by focusing on one particular model, which is being favoured throughout Australia at present, has meant that we haven't paid significant attention to alternative models which are more likely to be constitutionally valid, are more likely to give us better, cheaper, faster, more effective remedies, and it will depoliticise the role of the courts.